This is episode 51 of the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast with Garrett Marshall.
Personalization, as you mentioned, is probably one of the top four that you see as a recurring theme over and over when you do research on the behaviors of the fitness consumer. In order to personalize your products and services, you need to intimately know your target. For a commercial operator, that might be a prospect or even their current member. And in order to do that, you need to, of course, know the target's behavior. And that really comes down to the value of data.
Welcome to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast for club owners, operators, and fitness professionals. I am your host, Josh Trent, and this is your number one trusted resource for the accelerating world of fitness technology. Each week, we bring you an expert interview with a global influencer at the crossroads of fitness and technology. You'll gain the insights, tools, and inspiration you need to stay connected to the pulse of what matters most for your fitness business in the age of exponential technologies. On this episode, we're joined by Garrett Marshall, the Divisional CEO of Fitness On Demand. We're discovering how digital video programming is helping fitness facilities enhance personalization, take advantage of the underutilized space, that dead space we all see in the off hours in clubs, and provide a greater variety of exercise formats to the consumer. We're also exploring how to leverage the consumer fitness groundswell we're seeing currently in our landscape through this digital video programming. Fitness On Demand is a market-leading delivery platform of virtual fitness, and since 2010, their services have allowed facilities around the globe to economically deliver premium fitness programs to their users through programming and services designed to optimize the club space, streamline operations, and give unparalleled variety. These are the types of services that you can add on to fitness facilities, apartment complexes, hotels, and many more. It's been shown that on average, functional training and studio rooms inside of clubs remain vacant almost 70% of the time. But these new technologies are allowing facilities to capitalize on this dead space and provide a new digital experience to their members. Aside from the traditional gym setting, we also see this feature becoming a powerful amenity at hotels and resorts and health facilities that want to provide customers with an effective and engaging workout experience 24 hours a day. But with this groundswell of consumer health and fitness awareness on the rise, how do we leverage these cloud-hosted technologies to take advantage of the underutilized space, reduce operating costs, and provide members with unique and engaging workout programming? Well, the answer to that question and much more takeaways for club owners, operators, and fitness pros in this episode with Garrett Marshall. Garrett Marshall is the Divisional CEO of Fitness On Demand, a market-leading developer of fitness delivery products for media and programming. Garrett combines a breadth of experience with an industry-specific, laser-focused career path, investing himself fully in each opportunity along the way. Garrett has been fortunate to play a role in several successful fitness businesses, and his achievements span a variety of employment positions in small and large organizational settings. I'd like to welcome Garrett Marshall to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast.
Hi, Josh. Thanks for having me.
You know, I got the pleasure of taking notes a little bit on our previous talk, this fitness on demand, how this is applying to the commercial fitness operator space. Today, we're talking about leveraging the consumer fitness groundswell. You were just getting back from club industry. Tell us, what was most surprising to you about the industry meetup at Chicago?
Well, you know, anytime you attend those trade shows, and there's several of them throughout the year, there's always new ideas that spring up. So I spoke out there yesterday at 10:30 and then had about a half an hour to kind of walk the trade show floor. And as you'd imagine, you know, you're picking up a lot of pamphlets and brochures just to kind of, I guess, trend cast.
Yeah. And the trend casting, we see this at all the different shows, right? Whether it's CES or IRSA or IDEA. This specifically, though, what is different about this trade show, in your opinion, compared to the rest?
You know, I think we're in a really interesting time, hence the subject of my talk yesterday. You know, we have a rising consumer health awareness, and a lot of commercial brands are asking themselves how to take advantage of that.
What's interesting, too, is when I look at all the different ways that people can receive fitness, you know, fitness on demand. We're going to talk about your road, how you got there. But fitness on demand, for people that don't know, what is this brand, Garrett? What do you do and why do you do it for the industry space?
We're an enterprise video distribution platform. Today, we have five distinct delivery products, and we focus on distributing that video to group fitness studios, functional training zones, and mobile devices.
The programs and services are designed to really help to optimize the space. Let's talk about gyms that have those dead times. I'm sure we've all been in a 24-hour or just any type of club, any size, where we just notice that there's rooms that are empty, right? The lights are off. Typically, it's the group X room. How do you maximize that space, that dead time, to really optimize this for the club?
We help them minimize the dead time would be the short answer. So, you know, the industry average across the globe is that those studios sit empty between 60 and 70% of the time. Our product is a cloud hosted solution that connects generally to a large format video display. That could be in a studio environment, like you mentioned, or in a functional training zone. And it makes programming that's designed by the leading programming brands around the world. It delivers that to our customer, generally, which is a health club, and allows them to make that space accessible on demand or by schedule 24 hours a day.
The consumer fitness preferences, what have you been hearing in conversations as you travel, when you go to different facilities? What are they asking for the most right now when we look at this demand of fitness, getting fitness on demand? Are there anything specifically that they're asking for, whether it be program delivery or any type of group training environment that's nuanced? What might that look like for their demands?
From a macro level, frequency and format are most in demand. So again, you talked about the empty studio times, having the ability to deliver more formats to meet member demand and just in more frequency in a way that's cost effective. And you know, Josh, the challenge for our industry is that group fitness traditionally has been one of the biggest operating expenses. I mean, typically you have rent, probably payroll, and then group fitness. So it's a very sought after amenity. The industry's recognized that. I think for the most part, no gym owner would argue with you that it's probably the most engaging amenity of all commercial fitness, but it's also one of the most expensive. So our product is uniquely positioned, being one that can help our customer add more value through that frequency and format while at the same time reducing some costs.
Well, since 2003, you've had one foot in fitness. And I think really when I look at your career, one foot in technology, Garrett, can you give us a quick snapshot, man, of how you actually got to be where you are now working with fitness on demand? What does that story look like?
It's funny to hear you say that. And it's funny for me sometimes, you know, you get in the habit of thinking as you speak. But I used to always kind of kick off my bio by saying, you know, I'm not a technologist. And I've been in technology now for about 10 years, and I fell into it by accident. But now that's become the majority of my career. So still don't consider myself a technologist. But I've been in the industry for about 15 years. And the majority of that, as I mentioned, has now been in technology. I started on the retail side of the business on the in clubs. And held a variety of positions there. I spent 6 years with Lifetime Fitness and had the privilege to be part of the IPO of Lifetime Fitness in 2003-2004. As the economy went into the downturn, the position that I held with Lifetime, the last position that I had was as a regional sales lead for the pre-sales division. So I would go around to all the new markets where we were opening clubs, and I would help hire the general manager and the training staff who had launched that market. And back then, we were doing that sometimes a year in advance before we'd even put a shovel in the ground. So my job was to generate revenue in those regions. So we would set up like a triple wide trailer outside the property. We'd hire a sales staff. They'd start selling memberships. I would also call in like Fortune 500 companies. We had a portfolio of wellness products, which was pretty innovative for none of the private fitness operators were doing that at the time. So that was another part of the revenue stream. When the economy turned south, I think in 2007, we had like 17 clubs slated for open, and we only actually opened 7. So it had a pretty direct impact on my travel schedule and just income opportunities, et cetera. That's when I decided to look for other opportunities. And I met a couple of guys who had this idea for a virtual product, and we founded a company called Fitness on Request. It's now called Wellbeat. So I did that for about 3 years before I left to help launch Fitness on Demand, which is where I'm at now. And we established FOD in May of 2011.
I think it's interesting that you mentioned you started out in fitness and you didn't consider yourself a technologist, but I almost feel like, Garrett, right now, any club operator or trainer, they're all technologists. I mean, technology is integrating into everything that we do. Specifically, when we look at this groundswell, what you talked about at Club Industry for leveraging consumer fitness, tell us why you had this talk. What was this presentation all about? And then we'll dive in.
You know, so the purpose of the presentation was just kind of to open the minds of our commercial market to the opportunities and the growth of the fitness consumer market, meaning people who exercise regularly but do not belong to a gym. You had asked a question earlier, you know, what's in the mind of commercial operators? And we've been privileged with our product category to be on the forefront of a lot of those discussions with some of the leading and most innovative commercial brands. And they all know that having a digital strategy and in particular a mobile strategy is really important. But I don't think anyone's quite nailed that down. So fortunately for us, we get to be part of those conversations because a lot of the club operators are looking for maybe at least interested in hearing what our interpretation of that is.
The big space here that's growing even more almost every quarter, you talked about this, and we'll link actually your presentation here in our show notes so that club operators can check it out. Daily Burn, this is surprising, has 2.5 million members for these live 30-minute workouts daily, and that's just one of many. When we look at the video training space and how people receive fitness instruction via video, do you believe there's any projected numbers that we could actually trust, or what do you think this space will grow into in 2018, the video trainer aspect?
You know, it's a really good question. The lines, of course, are so blurry because how you segment these product categories is open for interpretation. So one of the things that I did in my talk yesterday was help the commercial operator explore some of the consumer fitness product categories that are having real success. Because fortunately for us in the commercial market, we don't have to completely retool or reinvent the marketing strategy for the fitness consumer. There's a lot that we can learn from or extract from some of the product categories that are having real success. You mentioned video trainers. That's a great one. You know, I want to point out with Daily Burn as an example, those are 2.5 million paying members who pay somewhere between $10 to $20 a month. Daily Burn's specialty is a live streaming video. Not a lot of people are doing that. We have live streaming available through our commercial product, but one of the challenges that we face is we don't produce the content ourselves. We rely on these global brands and leading brands in that space to produce that content. That's part of our business model. And no one besides Daily Burn is really doing that consistently. But as you know, with Daily Burn, they broadcast this 30-minute live workout literally 365 days a year. And I think what Daily Burn is after is really an experience. So, you know, those of us that have been in the industry, we understand the value of that tribe effect or the group effect that you get when you're part of something. They've used technology to bring that into the homes of people whose schedule may permit them from getting access to that, or maybe just they're too intimidated to be part of that in a commercial setting.
When we look at the factors that are appealing to consumers, you list out experience, convenience, personalization, and education. Let's talk about the personalization piece, because this is the era where fitness is really a prescription for wellness. And we talked about this on the show, how people can deliver, you know, different teaching modalities through digital tech, through this fitness on demand. Tell us about this personalization piece, the importance of personalization when we look at the factors that appeal to consumers.
Yeah, personalization, as you mentioned, is probably one of the top four that you see as a recurring theme over and over when you do research on the behaviors of the fitness consumer. In order to personalize your products and services, you need to intimately know your target. For a commercial operator, that might be a prospect or even their current member. And in order to do that, you need to, of course, know the target's behavior. And that really comes down to the value of data. You know, as an industry, there's a couple of ideas I guess I could share with personalization or things that I've been promoting. I start by saying this. I think all of our marquee training solutions in the fitness industry, and a lot of the more innovative club operators are already doing this, they have to be data-driven experiences, and then we need to get access to that data.
Yeah.
So I'm talking about, you know, everything from the whatever your intake assessment is for a prospect or a customer, whether that's an HRA, a ParQ, a health, you know, whatever that is, that needs to start as a data-driven experience. Any session or vehicle that you have where a client would engage with the training staff, again, data-driven, and then all the group formats from boot camps to group fitness classes, small group training. Clubs need to integrate with things like heart rate training. They've got to integrate with wearable devices, et cetera. And data needs to be on the forefront of each of those experiences.
What's interesting too is that if you have a great customer experience, a solid customer journey, that's one piece of it. But there has to be continuing education for fitness professionals and staff from the different people we've had on the show. We know that the top-down leadership must be in place. What do you do when you talk to clubs that are integrating your technology? What does that conversation look like from an integration standpoint from the top down so that the trainers on the floor know why they're doing and how to do it?
Such a good point. You know, one of the phrases we toss around loosely is that, you know, our product, as much as it's designed to be on demand and be a self-service tool, it's a product that really requires implementation and not just installation.
Yeah.
We have a pretty comprehensive onboarding process, which takes 28 days. We do that with every new customer. And then on an ongoing basis, you know, just like anything else, especially any other type of disruptive innovation, it's a continual process and it's a mindset shift. We've found that when you talk about organizations as a whole, the ones who do really well with our product understand it and can talk about it in all functional areas of the organization, not just in the group fitness department, but the sales staff who are taking members and prospects on tours, the training department, et cetera. And the clubs that do really, really well with this are the ones that talk about virtual as just one spoke in the wheel of their group fitness department. When you look at virtual as a separate delivery model to live and you juxtapose those, that's when we see some challenges.
And I think too, looking across the space, one of the gaps that's filled really by technology the best is taking that data and making meaning out of it. How are you integrating wearables into this journey for fitness on demand? Are there something like a readout, maybe a MyZone platform, or you're integrating with something where the instructors can use your platform in combination with wearables, or just tell us in any way how wearables are tied into fitness on demand?
Great question, Josh. And that kind of comes back to the brief conversation we had about personalization, where wearables have had the biggest impact in our product currently is through our mobile apps. And that's a personalization effort. So we launched an iOS and an Android marketplace app in March of this year so that the end users of our product, and traditionally, so you could look at our apps as like B2B to C solutions. Traditionally, we've been a B2B focused business. But as the population of end users grow, and today we're probably servicing somewhere between 3 and 5 million end users, just depending on how you do the math, made up of our commercial customers around the world. We've designed these products so that they can get access to their routine and their regimen, their fitness on demand regimen, when they can't make it into the four walls of the gym. We've chosen to integrate with the health kits, both on Google Play and on iOS, in order for them to capture, obviously, some of those key pieces of vital workout activity when they engage through the app. And so there's tons of personalization there. We have a kiosk typically in every commercial location that offers our service. And there's a number of ways that an end user can interact with that device. But being able to put it in their pocket gives us a whole slew of personalization features that we don't have access to just through the club.
I'm thinking about episode 39 with Shannon Fable, where she mentioned setting up the tech requires a really interesting skill set, Garrett, because it's not just about being able to utilize the program. It's also about being able to see kind of the bigger picture, what you want to accomplish with the technology, and then distill it down to what you must input to get the desired outputs. What are the inputs that we see in the group environment, whether it be that wearable data, whether it be specific programming? What is the recipe for success when we look at video application in the actual club space in that group setting?
You know, that's a great question. There could be several answers. I would say a macro formula that's really important from the commercial side of our business is understanding how to balance supply with demand. So that's very much a part of the onboarding process for any new customer. We help them break their calendar down. Most, I would say over 95% of our customer base have comprehensive live programming that they're using virtual to supplement. When you bring that product in, sometimes there's a conflict of interest. Sometimes it's a competitive threat to the to the human resources that are delivering the live experience. But just like with any product, there's multiple stakeholders that are involved, from the leadership in that club, the executive team, the group fitness department head, and then all the ancillary departments. It's a process of making sure that they understand how to meet supply with demand. So generally, our average customer is reducing their live programming by 10 to 15%. So not dramatically, but those are those classes and formats that they've had to carry over time to satiate member demand that have had very little cost benefit. So when our product comes in, not that it's designed to be a replacement tool for live programming, because it's not, but it, for those classes that have very low cost benefit, then it's a perfect replacement tool for that. But then it's an exercise of trying to figure out how to use scheduled virtual programming to meet those medium interest times of the day, and then when the product should be left open for on-demand use.
We've been talking about the medium box or even the large facility, but let's shift gears here, because the consumer space, you know, we have a lot of operators that listen to the show, and I am sure that in the commercial space, and we look at hotels and we look at these facilities where it's not the traditional gym setting, how does this experience plug in? In other words, what experiences are really proving successful to entice that demographic, the people that go to hotels? Maybe we can start this segment of the conversation off with you personally, Garrett. When you go to hotels, when you go in your travels, what makes you excited about getting your exercise in, getting your fitness program on demand there?
I think for me, it's accessibility. When I travel, I don't have a ton of time, but exercise is a priority for me. So there's nothing worse than having just a very limited offering or very limited amount of space. But I think the silver lining maybe in that today is a lot of hoteliers are waking up and realizing that having the right amount of space doesn't necessarily mean the largest capital expense in the gym, because, you know, guests are trending more in the direction of things, you know, products like ours and functional training that don't require those significant capital investments. So for me, it's accessibility and time.
And I think too, when we look at the novelty aspect, people are always looking for an engaging process. So if we're going to entice this demographic, specifically the boomers, right? When boomers travel, it's a much different experience than the millennials. How have you seen the boomers respond to fitness on demand when you contrast the digital literacy of millennials?
My gut instinct, and I shared this with you, I think when we were talking earlier, when I left the retail side of the business with Lifetime and I migrated to fitness on request, I had a healthy skepticism about virtual. I thought it was really innovative and a great way for me to be able to offer a savings and more value to the customers of this product. But I had a healthy skepticism about it because my previous life, with Lifetime Fitness, we spent millions of dollars annually on live programming. But your gut instinct would tell you that this is a product that would captivate the millennial as a priority. But we really haven't seen that when we've looked across the demographic information, the usage information. It's really people of all walks of life. And one of the biggest misconceptions, I think, by the audience or the prospect audience for this product is, will my member like it, regardless of their age? And, you know, when you look again at the people who interact with this product, it's never a situation where they're deciding, where they're choosing between a live event and a virtual event. Mm-hmm. The people that use virtual, they're choosing between virtual or nothing else at all. And that's generally because of schedule constraints and conflict of interest that prevent them from engaging in live programming.
The ideas around improvements here, let's go into our last phase of the show before we get into our Fit 6 round, when we talk about ideation around some of the novelty that we could see with augmented reality. How do you think AR will tie into fitness on demand in the next couple of years?
That's a good question. You know, that, and it's probably a better question for our content providers. I haven't spent a ton of time thinking about that. What I do know is for a subject matter like AR, when it becomes as mainstream as it has more recently.
I think it's surprised so many people, Garrett, you know, how much it's speeding into our industry here. We see it on a lot of different platforms, mobile, and I'm just curious how it might integrate into fitness on demand in clubs and in hotels too. I could see someone getting rewards and maybe having a heads up display. And, you know, we see this with the Apple updates. There's augmented reality that's really entering at a quick speed.
Yeah, you're right. You know, unfortunately, the commercial fitness industry, we've always been a few years behind the technology curve. So I think it's a couple of years before you actually see that manifest itself in everyday products and services. Yeah. But there's no doubt it's not slowing down anytime soon.
What is one thing that people get misconstrued about this digital fitness on demand? In other words, has there been one story that you've heard that's just simply not true about the real value of fitness on demand? Is there anything people constantly confuse that you believe you could shed a better light on?
Well, I think it just comes back to the last point that I made. You know, a lot of operators have been stuck on the question of, will my members like it? And that's kind of a misconception of the value proposition with virtual technology, because again, the people that use this product aren't choosing between live and virtual. They're choosing between virtual or nothing else at all. And the analogy that I always like to use is, if you're a major AC/DC fan, there's nothing better than experiencing AC/DC in Times Square live. But the reality is there's MP3s of Hell's Bells and TNT and all of that's everywhere, because that's just a more consumable format and a more cost-efficient way to experience that media. And I think to the same extent, that's very much true for our product category.
And I think too, with the ability for technology, as you mentioned here, personalization being one of the five key things, when we truly personalize using tech, we can get as close to the real experience as possible. And people that are working out at different times of the day, the real value that I'm seeing here with fitness on demand, you can finally use that space in the gym during those dead times and entice people to go there. Let's wrap this up, Garrett. This is the last section of our show. This is six questions for six of your real answers. Are you ready?
I'll try my best.
Now, I didn't prepare you for this, so this is totally organic here. What have you relied most about yourself when it comes to true leadership in the fitness industry? In other words, what do you believe that you've developed in yourself as a business professional to truly lead in our space?
I fall back on my conviction and purpose. I really enjoy improving things, particularly people, and when I have the opportunity to have an impact on business. So when times are challenging here, and you know, we're a six-year-old business, so they still are very much every day, I don't have a secret recipe. I try to fall back on my purpose for why I started this at the beginning.
Share with us that purpose too, because it's really unique. What is your ethos as to why you do personally what you do?
I want my work to be meaningful, and I enjoy improving people's lives. And if I have the opportunity to transition that into an impact on business and my career, then that's the best of both worlds. And I feel like this is a product category that allows me to do that.
Since 2003, you've been in the industry, but what is something that most people don't know about you? There's a lot of your talks and information about you online, Garrett, but what's something that most people don't know about Garrett Marshall?
That's a good question. I would say one thing that normally surprises people is I'm traditionally not an early adopter. I am not the guy who sleeps in a tent outside of Apple for the next iPhone release.
What tech devices do you use personally that have helped you in both your life or your health? Any devices or apps or software that you use on a regular basis?
Probably one of the things that's benefited me the most, and I gospel about it, is a productivity app called Tootaloo. It's a basic task system, and I hate saying that word, so I regret even doing it on this podcast, but it's a great product. And the best feature about it is it's integrated with Siri. So I have a parking lot established there where any idea that comes to me anytime on the road, I can just speak it to the phone and it gets logged. And then I have a system of, you know, going through and prioritizing that parking lot each day. So without that, I'd be blind.
Wow. I have not heard of that app before. We'll link that in the show notes. And what would you say the primary function of that app is for a busy pro?
Task management. And I've got that tool integrated across all of our departments in the company. So it's pretty streamlined that way. And then I shouldn't even put my wife out there like this, but we use it domestically in our house as well. So everything's connected. And for me, it's important. Everything's got to go into that tool or I can quickly lose track of it.
When you're traveling, you know, a lot of people listening, they're on planes quite a bit throughout the year. What do you personally do, Garrett, when you're traveling to maintain your health? Are there any habits, personal habits that you have that have really allowed you to step into health and wellness when you're out there on the road?
Yeah, I'm sure like a lot of us that do this for a vocation, we have our, you know, a lot of unique tips and tricks. For me, nutrition is key. I always have two meal replacements every day to try to get to my six meals. So planning meals and planning nutrition prior to traveling is the most important to me. And I have found a way to bring these meal replacements. I pack them dry and then I bring them with me. So if you're ever out traveling with me, you'll notice a lot of times I'm carrying around a shaker. But again, I think nutrition is so important. If you want to be 100% of yourself, then nutrition is the first place to start.
And I don't think you're that big of an outlier because there's probably a lot of people in the fitness space that carry protein powders with them and shaker cups. When we look at this leveragement of the consumer fitness groundswell, tell club operators that are listening, what are just a couple things they can do literally right now or tomorrow? What can they start looking at to leverage this consumer fitness groundswell?
There's a lot of things. Again, I think the four attributes you see when you research what products are having success with fitness consumers today, their experiences, convenience, personalization, and education. Education being something that's so ubiquitous now for consumers that it's almost more of an expectation than it is a driver on fitness consumers. So in terms of boiling that down to actionable ideas, you know, being able to create signature modules or programs in your gym, that's really important. That's a form of creating experience. Creating designated training zones that are either aimed at age-specific or interest-specific groups, that could be another idea. And then all of the things that you can do on the digital front. I mean, if you're interested in trying to penetrate this hard-to-reach market of fitness consumers, then it goes without saying that you've got to have a fully functional digital storefront online that's intuitive and easy for those people to engage with, because we know that online, just like a lot of other product categories and industries, is the number one channel that consumers are using to do their research. So most of the time anymore, they're not picking up the phone to call you or walking in your establishment. So having a deep and professional online presence is a must.
Thank you for reminding us about that, because I think it's easy to forget that, you know, when the club operator is going through their normal kind of hectic, sometimes busy day, sometimes we forget, I believe, that the digital presence is just as important as the brick and mortar. This is our last question here, and it's around the intersection of fitness and tech. What opportunities do you see possible for both business and health at this intersection of technology and fitness?
I think that there's going to be a lot of evolution in the budding preventative healthcare cause. With everything that's happening, you know, with the rise in awareness amongst fitness consumers, the advancements in the commercial space, and then the investment that a lot of the big tech companies like Google and Microsoft are making, I think eventually there's going to be a bridge created there. And wearable devices, as one example, represent true beachhead and conduit to this fitness consumer population that has started that process. So I'm interested to see where things go.
This is a very deep topic, this fitness on demand, not just in the commercial fitness space, but also in pretty much every segment of digital fitness, how people are consuming content now. So this has been a great conversation exploring, I believe, kind of the tip of the tip, Garrett. If people want to learn more about you, obviously they can hit you up on LinkedIn, linkedin.com/Garrett Marshall. Also, fitnessondemand247.com. Do you feel like there's anything we missed?
It's such a pleasure to be here. I think we've canvassed a good starting point. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Garrett. Garrett believes that although it's one of the most engaging amenities, group fitness has also traditionally been one of the largest operating expenses. To address the issue, Fitness on Demand is uniquely positioned to help the customer add more value with digital video programming by offering added frequency availability and a variety of training formats at the same time reducing labor costs. Clubs can seek out technologies like FOD to offset the expenses of underutilized space for digital replacement to live group classes. Personalization is one of the top appealing factors we see over and over when researching the behaviors of fitness consumers. In order to personalize products and services, we must intimately know the target demographic. This means we understand our customers' behaviors, whether it be a current member or a new prospect, and achieving this comes down to the value of data we collect as a club owner or operator and how we act and execute based on that info. Garrett shared with us that in order to effectively integrate and utilize new tech in the club, there needs to be continuous education for fit pros and staff. It's imperative to take a top-down leadership approach to ensure every level of employee within the club, from management to trainer and sales staff, knows exactly what the integration of new tech will achieve and has a complete understanding of why they're doing it and how it can easily communicate that message to members and new prospects. Video programming and fitness on demand is no longer just a trend. It's a viable industry segment that all professionals in our space are taking a deeper and more insightful look at as we move closer to 2018. Thank you for listening to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast. Here's a quick message from Brian O'Rourke.
Hello, everyone. This is Brian O'Rourke. Thanks for listening to the Fitness Plus Technology Podcast. I also want to extend our thanks to Josh and the many, many wonderful professionals who've contributed their time and expertise for free for the health club and fitness industry at large. Wouldn't you like your fitness brand, product, or service to be featured on a podcast like this? I know I would. And that's why the Fitness Industry Technology Council, myself, and our companies like Moon Mission Media, Bidari Ventures, and Vertimax, amongst others, have been underwriting the podcast for the last 9 months. Check the show notes for details. And consider becoming a sponsor. It's a great way to reach thousands of industry professionals in the fitness and health club space and be a part of educating people on technology adoption and all the opportunities it's going to provide. So please consider joining us here at the podcast, and we look forward to the many series of podcasts ahead. Thanks so much.